Hi, I'm Janek Gwizdala. If you are new to the channel, I want to quickly let you know why it's here, how it can help you get more out of your music, and what it is exactly that I do on a daily basis to improve my learning process and be a better musician. I think the process is all about maximizing the time we have to get the most out of what we love. And as you saw at the top of the video, through the lens of the 2-5-1 progression, we're exploring how you can better invest in your playing and make the most of your time spent working on music. Whether you play for fun sometimes on the weekends, are in college and planning to pursue a career in music, or are just about anywhere else on that spectrum, you will never be without the need for fundamentals. The basic mechanics of technique, harmony, melody, rhythm, sound, and time. The more you work on them, the more you can forget them. And I don't mean that literally. I mean that the more consistent you are with absorption of basic building blocks into your playing, the less you'll have to be conscious of them when it comes to executing musical ideas and expressing yourself to your audience. To illustrate this, being a musician that comes from a predominantly jazz background, I want to use some melodic ideas based around the 2-5-1 cadence. It's one of the fundamental building blocks of jazz vocabulary and makes up a huge part of the harmonic platform upon which jazz standards and contrafracts are not only written on, but subsequently used as a framework for improvisation. I am not about to just let that word slide by without explaining it. A contrafract is basically a new melody written over a familiar chord sequence. This is something popularized by jazz musicians like Charlie Parker, Dizzy Gillespie, Miles Davis back in the 1940s. And maybe one of the most famous examples of this, especially for us bass players, is Miles and Bird's Donnelly, which used the chord changes to the jazz standard Indiana. I'm sure you all know the legendary Jaco Pastorius version of this, recorded on his debut album in duet with Don Alias. So even if you've never heard of the term contrafract, I'm pretty sure you've heard one and have a connection to this terminology, perhaps without even knowing it. Here's a quick modern example of a contrafract that my great friend Mike Stern wrote over the chord changes of There Is No Greater Love. This is his song Coupe de Ville from a European tour with myself, Mike, Randy Brecker, and Steve Smith live at Ronnie Scott's in London. It's ad time. As you can see, I am not Casey Neistat or MKBHD, and therefore do not have big ticket sponsors like NordVPN or Squarespace. So I'm going to take just 20 seconds of your time to sponsor this video with something very appropriate for today's 2-5-1 topic, and that is my book, Jazz Vocabulary for Electric Bass 2-5-1. It comes with video examples of all the exercises in different tempos, standard bass notation, bass tab, and even has a treble clef appendix for all you non-bass players watching. Everything is linked below in the description of this video. Digital copies are available at janekgwizdala.com and physical copies via Amazon. Now let's get back to the show. As always, I want to preface the following examples by saying that they are merely tools to facilitate repetition of a concept. They are not meant to be the end result of your vocabulary content. I compiled these ideas as a solution to a problem, the problem being the necessity for repetition of something I heard on a recording that I loved and the fact that I wanted that sound to be a natural part of my playing. There is no substitute for making listening, ear training, and transcription a massive priority in your learning process, no matter what style of music you play. All the musicians you love to listen to and that inspire you to play music all have one very important thing in common. They all did the work. They didn't learn licks from a book. They didn't employ any shortcuts or hacks. They immersed themselves completely in the music they loved, and they let their curiosity fuel their desire to improve. So use these examples as a potential framework for your process and not as an end result of what you want your playing to sound like. So where to start? I think it's a good idea to be aware of what it is you need to work on. You know, perhaps is your time a little shaky? Do you get a little hung up on alto chords? Are there certain keys you're less familiar with than others? Answering these questions can inform the process so much and take all the doubt out of where to start your practice session, how to navigate the journey, and how to reach and ultimately reset your goals to push you further. This first 2-5 shape is descending and ascending in half steps. It's actually a great phrase to use as a warm-up, but it can also be the entire content of a practice session if you have the discipline and desire to work it at a multitude of tempos and play it all over the neck. Let's also take a listen to this shape at 2 higher tempos to give you some more context and illustrate how the phrasing changes with each tempo and how you have to adjust your technique and articulation the higher the tempo rises. Consistency is hugely underrated when it comes to our practice time. I hear of people who spend hours at a time with the instrument, but then don't touch it for days on end. You know, choosing the amount of time you spend with the instrument, of course, comes down to context, but once you're clear about your goals, it's really important to make sure consistency is at the forefront. And I'm literally talking about 15 minutes a day, if that's all you've got. I strongly believe that 15 minutes a day is far more valuable than 6 hours on Monday and then not touching the instrument until Friday. This next example is exercise 19 from the 251 book. And if my goal is just 15 minutes a day, I'll work with a metronome or play along, starting slow, hitting all 12 keys, and then increase the tempo to find my ability threshold. This can vary from increasing the tempo in increments of maybe 2, 5, or 10 BPM to completely random tempos, you know, just to keep me on my toes. This gives me feedback about my ability with the initial goal of playing the phrase in 12 keys, and also about where my technique limitations are. As always, time and sound are at the forefront of my process. No matter what the notes are, the style, the tempo, it's all about practicing with the right intent and having great sound and time when you play. My 251 book comes with a pretty solid listening list for learning this kind of vocabulary, and I would highly recommend checking out the Spotify playlist linked below in the description of this video so you can really start to pay attention to the difference in each artist's time and sound. Cannonball Adderley and Art Pepper both play alto saxophone and both play jazz standards, but they couldn't sound more different in their time, their phrasing, and their sound. The same goes for comparing Ben Webster and John Coltrane, or Grant Green and Jim Hall. When you listen to these players and transcribe their lines, try and play that material along with the record so exactly that perhaps you can only hear one instrument. That is to absorb their feel and figure out how they treat each note in relation to the next. It's the details in articulation and phrasing that are ultimately going to give you the tools to create your own unique time and sound. Check out this last example in three different tempos and pay close attention to the details of time, sound, and phrasing. And stick around to the end of the video for the metric modulation solution to what I was playing in our opening clip. So I will leave you with a rhythmic and technical challenge to add to your practice routine. It's what I was doing in the opening clip of the video. And when you break it down, it's super simple, yet very effective when you're in control of it. It's basically taking a four-note shape and then playing that same shape but phrased in triplets. I'm using the first example we looked at, playing it in two key centers, descending in half steps, and then playing it three times, phrased in eighth note triplets. This pattern of two and three is just one way of the phrase landing on the downbeat each time. But I think the real challenge is to be in control of this no matter what the phrase or the tempo. Boom, 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 boom I really appreciate you making it this far in the video, and it would be awesome if you could hit the thumbs up if you dig what you've seen, subscribe to the channel so you know exactly when these videos are launched, and maybe leave a comment below if you want some direct feedback on something. But again, thank you for spending some of your incredibly valuable time with me, and I'll see you guys on the next video.